welcome to the penultimate session of 2.5 weeks, 3 weeks of a marathon of sessions of our conference dedicated to border Italian borderlands. We're delighted to have you here. I want to remind you before we begin that tomorrow we have our keynote. We end the conference with our keynote. And with that, let me just remember to thank everyone who has been working behind the scenes thus far. And I will mention them all tomorrow. Today, we're going to, the session is Crossing Borderlines with Ulysses' Second Eye, Searching for Italy's Identity in Il Secondo Occhio di Ulisse. Now, I have a number of things that come to mind, cute things I think I could say, maybe not so cute about Ulisse, but we'll save that for our discussion. We're going to vary a bit from the normal procedure, which has been to have questions after each speaker, seeing how we have one topic, one individual we're discussing. We thought we would then save everything until the end. So we have four speakers. One, unfortunately, is engaging in civic duty, but she did record her talk. And so we will be delighted to hear Simona Wright. I want to give the session over to Silvia Calorosi, who has organized it all and also one of the co-editors of the book from which this conference, this session has evolved. Prego, Silvia.
Grazie mille. Well, thank you. First of all, thanks a lot to Calandra, to the Calandra Institute for hosting the conference, not only, but for sticking with it after last year's throwback, let's say. But we're really glad to be here, and I'm very happy to talk to you about this volume, Il Secondo Occhio di Ulisse, which is a literary and cultural voyage in search for Italy's identity. It constitutes a collection of essays written by Professor Emeritus Sante Matteo during the course of his career, which span the history of Italian literature, cinema, and culture. The essays here translated into Italian by the three editors, Maria Silvia Riccio, Simone Dubrovic, and myself, editors whom I'm delighted to represent here today. They take the reader on a voyage from the Middle Ages to contemporary times in search for a continuous redefinition of the Italian identity, navigating between and across the boundaries of an Italianness in continuous flux, from Marco Polo and Dante, whose horizontal and vertical journeys respectively serve to renew and redefine Italy's place in the world and in history, to the cross-boundary text of expatriate writer Jose Rimanelli, who continued to be an Italian writing during his 60-year activity in America after he crossed Italy's geographical boundaries and looked at Italy from the outside. It is a book that wants to create a bridge and bring across borders the work of Sante Matteo, who wrote in English as an inhabitant of the US to address topics and literatures from another border, Italy, literally from one, from the other side of that border. It was also edited and cured across borders from those who came to the US for a borderline experience 20 years ago or more. And two of us, namely Simone and I, ended up staying. We all shared with Sante not only our first steps within the American academia, but also our dual cultural identity. And working on this volume meant for us to revisit Italy and Italy's multi-identity, looking at it from a distance. Italy has historically been a land in balance between a definition of its identity, the creation of stylistic and linguistic unifying models, its plurality and multiculturality. Sante's investigations thus bring the reader to a transnational voyage. In the age of mobility, migration, and transnationalism, Sante's investigations are a constant reminder of what it means to define a language and a culture, and which opposite forces may come into action. He looks at it with a critical and binocular eye, which explores the ever-changing notions of Italy and Italianness, employing a unique perspective that highlights aspects of Italian language, culture, and history that are still very up to date today. If nowadays, in fact, literature is an expression of a lively culture and should be addressed to a transnational reader, Santes Ives brings to light the very roots of this phenomenon. Pairing together figures not usually linked together, such as Marco Polo and Dante, or Pinocchio and Garibaldi, Santes illuminates new aspects of classical and canonical literary works, uncovering some of the most remarkable aspects. The secret Santes reveals to us is to look at the margins, but always with a stereoscopic eye, similar to that acquired by the traveler Ulysses and by migrant writers and scholars, to interpret how cultural production in different periods was shaped by conflicting forces and tensions, and how those cultural products in turn shaped the cultural currents that followed down to today's world of mobility, migration, transnationalism, both in and outside Italy. The portrait of Italy that does result is a mental dimension suspended between past and present, fiction and reality. While readers are invited to redefine the nation's identity, but also their own identity, in order to find their new own home. The volume, as I mentioned, engages the reader on a trip, a literary and physical trip that works as an opportunity to understand oneself more in depth. Italy is, in fact, a land that does not allow you to live indefinitely, thus not to go back either. It is a land that lives in a double dimension across borders, like we do. So after this really brief introduction, I will let our panelists give us their insights about the book.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you, Silvia. So what we're going to do is, so you know, in case you're following the program, we're going to have a slightly different order. We're going to begin first with a recording by Simona Wright. As I mentioned, she couldn't be here. Then we will pass on to Peter Caravetta, then Wiley Feinstein, and then finally Daniele Fioretti. So our first speaker is, by way of technology, Simona Wright, the title of who is professor at the College of New Jersey, and the title of her talk is The Unification of Italy and the Making of Italians, from Garibaldi to Emigration.
Dear colleagues and fellow borderlanders, I'm delighted to present today my humble contribution to the conference and its notion of borderlands, and to celebrate at the same time the literary and critical contributions of Dr. Santes Matteo, with whom we all share a lifelong dedication to the field of Italian studies. Common to all of us Italianists is also an interrogation and a renegotiation of our identity and sense of national and cultural belonging. And to this particular topic, I would direct my presentation today. But first, I would like to apologize for my absence due to circumstances beyond my control, and to thank the organizers of the conference, Dr. Joseph Shora and Silvia Carlo Rosi, for their gracious invitation and for allowing me to read this paper in absentia. My gratitude also goes to Dr. Anthony Tamburri for chairing this panel. I reviewed with pleasure the volume edited by Silvia Carlo Rosi, Maria Silvia Riccio, and Simone Dubrovic, who selected and translated some of Professor Matteo's most engaging scholarly explorations. Il secondo occhio di Ulisse, Saggi di letteratura e cultura italiana, is an authoritative volume that attests to the variety of scholarly interests and the intellectual depth of its author. In the table of contents, the essay entitled What Rises Up Again in the Risorgimento and How Do They Make an Italian? Garibaldi, Pinocchio, Cuore, and Emigration, piqued my interest, for in it, Professor Matteo juxtaposes the political and historical planes with the literary production of the post-unification period, concentrating on what could summarily be described as children literature. Examining Collodi's The Adventures of Pinocchio and, more tangentially, De Amicis's Cuore against the backdrop of Garibaldi's post-unification exile, Matteo proposes a textured examination of a period that, as contemporary Italians, never ceases to interpolate us. tackling the question of nationhood, identity, and national belonging through literary texts for children invites questions regarding the early stages of the unification project, exposing issues that linger until the present day and, just to mention the most pressing one, inhibit Italy from being a relevant player on the geopolitical arena in both the Mediterranean and Europe. Matteo tackles the Vexata question, making the Italians, by contrasting Garibaldi's military exploits, his thwarted ideas of a republican nation and his subsequent glorification, to the adventures of the little block of wood, which, after many vicissitudes, missteps, and poor decisions, is gifted with a real body. From the perspective of Ulysses' second eye, Matteo contemplates the complexity of the unifying operation and its repercussions on its young and unaware protagonists, like Enrico Bottini from De Amicis' Cuore, whose private diary is exposed to his father's unauthorized intrusions. The father's notes exude bourgeois values and examples of national abnegation, while Enrico's reality at school is one of poverty, exclusion, and gloom. In Pinocchio, as in Cuore, Italy is but a remote horizon, good for fairy tales and replete with frustrated aspirations. Ulysses' second eye functions in this essay as an oppositional gaze to reveal the cracks in the post-unification process, to make space for alternative narratives, and to give a voice to silenced marginalities. Post-unification Italy, Matteo reflects, is a far more complicated matter than history books convey. Much like in Dante's Commedia, where the lexical term I predominates, here, the act of looking corresponds to an analytical operation that is both epistemological and poetic. Garibaldi and Pinocchio could not, as historical representations, be more distant, yet they share a common condition, that of exile. Unification brought Garibaldi both grandeur and shocking disappointment. Elevated to the glory of national hero, he quickly became a nuisance for his outspoken criticism of the newly formed government. Intensely disliked by Victor Emmanuel II, even prior to the Impresa dei Mille, after the Third War of Independence, Garibaldi was readily pushed to the margins of Italy's political life and rendered innocuous. And while, as a principal agent of Italy's unity, he remained actively involved, the narrative about him was being refashioned, his military endeavors compressed in bronze monuments all over Italy, and his political principles oversimplified in political speeches and history manuals. Pinocchio's narrative existence is no less turbulent. A clumsy puppet striving to become a boy, Geppetto's creation is condemned to a wooden exile by a mix of naivete, continuous misunderstandings, and foolish decisions. No matter if strings constrain his movements, as in the Hollywood cinematic version, or if his legs move him awkwardly in only one direction, trouble, Pinocchio experiences the perennial exile of his undisciplined lack of consciousness, which condemns him back to his natural origins. The doubt that his final metamorphosis may not be final at all will trouble the mind of the readers as well as that of the viewers of Benigni's cinematic version. The condition of exile that Garibaldi and, as a literary character, Pinocchio experience becomes the leitmotif of Italy's unification, where the development of a national consciousness remains entangled in the quagmire of political expediences, special interests, and widespread corruption. Pinocchio's encounter with Mangiafuoco, the Cat and the Fox, and the Mastiff Alidoro are all manifestations, Matteo explains, of the insurmountable impediments any ordinary individual had to confront as a new Italian. Read in this light, Pinocchio's literary escapades can be approached, our critic notes, as a manual on how to shape the new Italians, but simultaneously as an account of the many instances that conspired to the failure of the national project. What Italy's reality offers today, with the contradictory views on the pandemic, the irresponsible behavior of both politicians and experts, and the scenes of crowds swarming in the various cities despite the social restrictions, are all somber reminders that national unity remains unaccomplished. In his essay, Matteo's eye lingers on the fairy's character, identifying her presence in the story as both a remnant of the ancient Cretonian superstitions and practices and a manifestation of the amoral familism and clientelismo so widespread even today. The fata seems to embody the Italian proclivity for the raccomandazione, the need for a powerful and magical intermediary that can solve a situation, grant a wish, and make the impossible a reality. But her presence is ominous as it is reassuring, for she can grant wishes and castigate at will. Collodi's fata serves us as an arbiter of Pinocchio's destiny, intervening to correct and punish, hinting at what continues to remain, to quote Machiavelli, fuora di ogni umana coniectura, outside of any human conjecture, end of quote. Her appearance signals the impending threat of what is unexpected and ruinous, and her advice points to the need for a virtuous behavior that protects from the ebbs and flows of Fortuna's destructive forces. If Pinocchio aspires to be a real boy, he must obey the rules of libero arbitrio and maintain order and control over his destiny as much as he can. Matteo identifies yet another dimension that complicates the development for Italians of a national unity and a shared cultural identity, the experience of migration, which connects the past with the present and which, I argue, can serve as a way out of the impasse experienced by the Garibaldis and Pinocchios of Italy. It may also give us new tools to help us redirect our research as Italianists, develop a more reality-based pedagogy, and more generally, produce a more cosmopolitan community, both in Italy and anywhere in the world where il si suona. There's no need to provide evidence that both Garibaldi and Pinocchio are transnational figures that have crossed physical, cultural, linguistic, and literary boundaries. During his exceedingly active life, Garibaldi was involved in military exploits, as well as in business ventures, in political and social activities that spanned several continents, in national governments, as well as in the management of his verdant Caprera property. Mapping his travels would substantially complicate any nautical map. He was a captain, a corsair, a commander, served in 6 different armies, was a general in various wars of independence in South America and, of course, in Italy. A reformist in any sense of the term, Garibaldi favored unions, the abolition of the death penalty, a progressive taxation on income, public education, universal suffrage, and the abolition of aristocratic titles. He was against revolution, even if he considered himself a proletarian. A patriot, he was ready to fight for Italy as long as it was for its liberation. Against colonialism, he favored the creation of a League of Nations to mediate international conflicts. Called by Lincoln at the beginning of the American Civil War to command one of the US Army's units, Garibaldi announced to the president's emissary that he would join the military efforts only if the war had it as its main objective, the abolition of slavery. A committed Republican, he fought on the side of Victor Emmanuel II, calling for the king to be at the head of the army and invoking the unity of all parties involved to end the diatribes and political disputes that would hinder the unification. Coherent to his principles, he would nevertheless abandon his personal views for the greater good of the country. His respect for the king, unfortunately, was not reciprocated, as we well know. Outside of Italy, his popularity was widespread. His impresa was followed throughout Europe, Great Britain, and Russia. A sailor by trade, in Constantinople in 1831, Garibaldi earns his living as a language preceptor. He speaks Italian, French, English, and Portuguese. He trades in pasta in Brazil, teaches math in Uruguay, works in a candle factory in New York. Wherever he lived, he met with Italian immigrants. As Italy existed already, an Italian identity was felt strongly. He was an officer in 6 different armies and a citizen of Italy, France, Peru, and Portugal, and Uruguay. He held an American passport, although US citizenship was actually denied, a story for another conference. Imbued since his encounter with the Saint-Simonians in 1833 with their socialist, pacifist, libertarian, and egalitarian principles, he embraced their ideals of freedom and liberty. Reminiscing on their encounter in his memoirs, he reflects and open the quote. "From them, I learned that a man who fights for his homeland, if he fights to defend it, is a soldier deserving respect. If he fights to attack, he will still be a soldier, but he deserves no respect. However, the man who, becoming cosmopolitan, adopts humanity as his homeland and offers his sword and his blood to any people who fight against tyranny, that man is more than a soldier. He is a hero." End of quote. A cosmopolitan and a citizen of the world, that is what, beyond the trite rhetoric of heroism, constitutes the epistemological foundation of a true human being, according to Garibaldi, and becomes the driving force of all his future endeavors. A life in fulfillment of the ethics of cosmopolitanism, of world citizenship, of principled resistance against all forms of tyranny, of coloniality and oppression, this is Garibaldi's legacy. His notion of patriotism challenges the very notion of national borders, transcends national interests to recognize a struggle for freedom and liberty for each and everyone. A true cosmopolitan, Garibaldi is the first modern transnational Italian, a citizen of the world that embodied ideals which fully resonate today as we witness the struggles of BLM, BIPOCs, and Asian Americans as they are fighting for dignity against the brutality of systemic racism. As expats, emigrants, exiled, we need to constantly renegotiate the notion of identity, subjectivity, and national belonging. Considering the example of Garibaldi and accepting the presence of the many Pinocchios in our cultural background, we cannot but define Italian identity as a plurality, a composite fabric of transnational experiences that include both emigration and migration, centripetal and centrifugal forces that invest our reality, complicating it with new but not insurmountable challenges. To conclude, if we talk about borderlands today, it is to highlight the unstable, in-between, and hybrid spaces they occupy. Margins are no longer lines, borders, but areas of growth, of encounter, of conflict, and also of contradiction. Borderlands constitute a new Roman limes, a territory of infinite possibilities, a cosmopolitan space rather than a sharp line of demarcation. My gratitude goes to Dr. Sante Matteo for eliciting, through this essay, a thoughtful reconstruction and reconsideration of Italy's post-unification and contemporary struggles. And thank you for your attention.
Hello again. So our second speaker is Peter Caravetta, who comes to us from Stony Brook University, where he is a professor of both philosophy and Italian studies. And the title of his talk is "Who Will Speak for Polyphemus?" Peter, prego.
Okay, first of all, many thanks to the Calantra Institute for organizing this conference, which has become an annual appuntamento of the highest order. And thanks for having me here. I want next to salute my good old friend, Sante Matteo, with whom I have been in dialogue sporadically under the rule of chance, much more than professional planning, for over three decades. I love his book and will refer to it, but I want to start with a first gloss on the title, Ulysses' Second Eye. But of course, Sante, two eyes are better than one. Two eyes technically allow us to determine the position and distance of an object by a phenomenon known as parallax, the distance between the eyes serving as the base of a triangle projected forward and of which the object represents the vertex. With one eye, we lose the sense of distance or of precision. Is that why Cyclops keeps on missing Ulysses' ship when he starts throwing boulders from the top of the ridge and to try to destroy no one? The name Ulysses, Odysseus. The metaphor clearly develops the notion of a Ulysses lost on the way back home, a navigator who is constantly seeking to rid his environment, the people and the monsters he meets, allowing him, however, to become a polytropos, the man of a thousand speeches, of a thousand rhetorical, the man of rhetorical skill. It's not his brawn, as with Achilles, but his brain, his language skills, that allows Ulysses to survive and eventually return. Sand, of course, is not interested in the Nostos as such. There is no Ithaca, the title of a film from a few years ago. For indeed, we as humans are really tossed into existence and roam forever until we die. Indeed, that was my theory in Sulle Tracce di Hermes, 2014, in which I came up with the notion that migrare humanum est, and that mobility, migration, is more important and primordial than setting roots, than stability, including metaphysical and political stability. It's a disquieting predicament. So the Ulysses metaphor or critical image needs to be rethought. For me, it never really worked, at least under a realist lens. The comparison does not hold. Ulysses is a bad choice to represent the immigrants. He was, after all, a king, a hero. As I stated many years ago, he is a leader, privileged, and though during the journey he is stripped to the barest, upon his return, he will regain Wachetra, his dutiful queen, disband the suitors, and reestablish order. Not so with the immigrants. Thus, for Sand, maybe what matters are the 19 and a half years spent sailing toward Troy and then the final arrival at Ithaca. Remember that more than half of the Odyssey deals with what happens after Ulysses lands and meets his old swineherd and his dog Argos. What matters are the years as migrant negotiating peoples, monsters, storms, and disease. Not too difficult to apply this to the history of Italians the world over, except that for these Italians, maybe for all of them, once again, there is no Italy to go back to. Oh my God. So what's their identity? But even worse, definitely against the grain of academic platitudes, Sand suggests that maybe there was no Italy to begin with, to take off from. Talk about a cultural, historiographical, and existential crisis. We are tossed in the middle of no man's land, pardon the no human's land. Through a series of brilliant readings, some will be glossed and have been glossed by my colleagues, Sand makes the case that perhaps Italy is not a place, but a mental dimension, a figura of the intellect, a yearning or desire without a precise object or determination. Oh, my friend Balvi Scusi would have loved that. Ellis Island is the poem that proves San De Matteo right. Kind of also reminds me of Ray Charles' Georgia on My Mind. The Italian persona, which is a theatrical metaphor, is an ever-changing, restless, metamorphic being. A force constantly creating for itself myths and legends about the Madre Patria and, in more down-to-earth terms, justification and legitimation for its peculiar identity, or actually, identities. These include Rome, the church, glorious artists, explorers, inventors, poets, but all of them, as has already been noted, all of them transnational, babelic, unrestrainable, who act and speak as both insiders and outsiders at the same time. Yes, Italy is merely a geographic expression in the immortal words of Prince Metternich. We continuously create and recreate it, sometimes with threatening success, other times through the ridiculous sublime, as he exemplifies in the case of his post-Risorgimento culture seen through the eyes of Pinocchio. What a revealing, a critically creative historical hermeneutic, which demonstrates how the fiction is developed in a few years to suit a dominant ideology of legitimation, emigration, and indeed colonialism. I remember in the 1980s, I was studying in Milan. The air was thick with no less than five different left-leaning parties. The socialist and communist had an almost hegemonic grip on culture. And I remember they made me hate Pascoli and Collodi, D'Annunzio and Garibaldi, tutti piccoli borghesi, they claimed. Not the right kind of progressive aristocratic Italian. Sand has made me appreciate Garibaldi, the true Italian who is essentially un oriundo in any country he lived in and fought for. But that ideology cum critical method would also ignore or underestimate the one of the leftists degli anni Ottanta, underestimate the import of the sottoproletari, the emigrants, creating, outside of a handful of experts, a huge black hole in the historical memory, almost as if the borghesia was ashamed of it, almost as if the borghesia did not want to confront its own racist and ethnic regional discrimination and pseudo-anthropology. Until by the beginning of this century, with immigration, as opposed to emigrations, Italian had to come to sort of a reckoning about their non-identity or the porousness of their claims and the duplicity of their politics. Perhaps the regional masks are the best icons or figures for the Italians, foremost Pulcinella and Arlecchino. In the 70s and 80s, most self-effacing characterizations of the Italians looked at films with Vittorio Gassman, Alberto Sordi, Nino Manfredi, and in some articles, the typical Italian was likened to the simpatico mascara-brained Paperino, Donald Duck, which had landed on the peninsula thanks to the shipping of supplies under the Marshall Plan. Sanders' reading of literature and the profession as basically allegories of what constitutes the non-Italians or the Italians who since forever seem to have adhered to grand monolithic identities, once again, Rome, the church, the bankers, universal geniuses, etc., while just as constantly sabotaging them are illuminating and tragic almost. Quote, Italy is a no man's land that lives in the dimension of the double. Take the Italian language, that was created artificially, basically from the top down, which is itself harbinger of this condition. I recall some 40 years ago studying historical linguistics with Paolo Valesio, fascinated by the incredible ductility of the code and learning that there are constructions possible whereby, through a compounded specific combination of the potential and the optative subjunctive, a speaker can hypothesize a situation, and whether it happens or does not, they were right. Incredible instrument, especially useful when they ask negative questions to which only a positive agreement is allowed in the interlocutor. One of the chapters described how this plays out in the way in which James Joyce is or should be considered an Italian author, but not simply because he actually wrote in Italian. He, the expatriate from his own travail, the native country, but also as the quintessential writer that needs to be outside the binding relationship speech territory and compose his masterpieces in English while living daily in this other country, actually a region, a small border town, a comune, right, between the crisscrossing of like several different mega cultures. This cannot but bring up inevitably the questions of Italian writing abroad. In two ways. First, American writings by Italians of two or three generations, starting with Pietro di Donato, which I would sort of him as a reverse of Giacomo Joyce. This would be the Italian science American streets propounded by Fred Gadafi. And then through something that finally came to public recognition thanks to the monumental work of Luigi Bonafini and Joe Perricone, the Italian diaspora texts or Italophone literature, no less interesting and important than any Francophone or Hispanophone literature. Indeed, it appears one has to be outside the country in order to fully see it, as Nietzsche had said of Germany while residing and writing from Rapallo. In another revealing reading on this book concerned the fate of Ugo Foscolo, another author caught between not two, but several worlds. Like Mazzini, like Garibaldi, Santa muses on how an obstinate myopic philologism for its own sake ends up being obsessed with the image or figura or projection of what Foscolo was or better was supposed to be, erecting a canon of meaningless minutiae built essentially on emptiness, il vuoto, says Santa, practically ignoring what he actually had said and done that was relevant, that spoke to notions that today we would call transnationalism, translation as the in-between terrain of any culture seeking for meaning, of conjoining fiction to historical reality during the Napoleonic era, and so on and so forth. Even our literary canonical heroes seem to me are fabrications for which we elect to ignore the reality of the subject. I mean, just think of Dante's stories, but please. No one paid attention to Foscolo's actual audience, to that reader which Sante claims, strada facendo, is the necessary other for literature to even exist in the first place. But one does not depart from Italy as well. Kind of reminds me of writings by William McNeill and Benedict Anderson, which with Sante we have often exchanged emails about these two historians, thinkers, on nationalism, where by extension nationality is really an imaginary category, something socially necessary, as the gods of thunder and the sun in Vico's Bestioni, yet unreal in terms of Platonic or religious universals. So basically being a practical fiction, a political discourse that only claims to be egalitarian and apolitical. And yet in his most sober moments, the critique that seems less devastating because couched in an almost conversational low register irony, which Sanders says is both a weapon and a shield, about the foibles of history, at one point it picks up momentum and strikes some powerful lines. After finally explaining the genesis of that Zeller symptomatic phrase, fatta l'Italia, ora bisogna fare gli italiani, and how it played out really among certain elites of vested interests. Remember that Italy was a monarchy, granted a constitutional monarchy, but still in the grips of aristocrats, nobles, super rich, landowners, alta borghesia, with 80% of the population was still illiterate, and so on and so forth. Sander reveals that what the representative Italians, that is, again, the upper thin slice that determined the fate of a nation, they basically said to the majority of the people, fatta l'Italia, vattene, which does not translate as Italy's achieved, now you can go, but rather Italy's ours. You're no longer needed, get the hell out of here, okay? And to Italy, one does not return in this kind of context. It being ceaselessly changing under those reassuring mythologies, bound to the outcast, the marginal, the underrepresented, the one from far away who rewrites in other loco beyond the borders, those same eternal monuments and glories. There is a distortion here, a rupture, a wound, a mysterious abyme. You recall, Umbertina's granddaughter cannot make sense of the Italy she wants to discover when she goes to study and live in Italy, in the Italy of her grandmother, which she thought was eternal. There is throughout the book a certain melancholy, a languore emanating from a sense of incompleteness and recurring misunderstanding. In going through exemplary moments in Italian literary cultural history, always make an incisive and critically stimulating observations. I mean, first and foremost, the juxtaposition Dante Marco Polo, which as far as I know, no one picked up on as a most intriguing phenomenon to explore further, or Machiavelli's Belfagor, a text which seems to have been written at the beginning of the 20th century, such as its subverting avant-gardistic creativity. Sante is already talking about an embedded post-colonial, post-modern predicament without the meta-language that I usually use in these kind of writings. I mean, it's much down to earth, much cleaner, much easier, and maybe more effective, as a critic. That highlights the profound historical existential themes. And these are being on the road, being both on the inside and outside of a given social milieu, being an incomplete being ever seeking, moving forward toward the inexistent destination, the inexistent Ithaca/Italy. Thus making us think of multiple identities as constitutive, not accidental, of overlapping social and historical patterns and the necessity to rethink the canon. Actually, I might say of tossing it away in order for us to begin to restitch it, journey after journey, text after text, interrogating them and reflectively us each time. So not just who wrote and where, when, but for whom was a particular text written. For literature is not a picnic, says Sande. It's not just the paper or the screen it is written on, but it expresses and embodies lives and their efforts to improve their lot. To conclude, Cyclops may have been impaired by his one-eyed reckoning of his pre-civilized world. Worse yet, he was practically blinded by no one, by Odysseus. But his name was Polyphemus, which etymologically means many speeches or many tongues. Perhaps Ulysses got away as much to return home as to tell the world how we can be monocular and polytropos at the same time. Italian culture seems to embody that perfectly. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Our third speaker is Wiley Feinstein, who's professor of Italian and Jewish studies at Loyola University. And the title of his talk is Screwball, Centrifugal Centripeti Italitude in Il Secondo Occhio di Ulisse. Prego, Wiley.
Okay, thanks. to Peter and everyone. We're running late on time, and so I want to go through my 12 minutes here. I'm going to start with a two-minute slide presentation to introduce you to some central themes that run throughout the 12 chapters of Il Secondo Occhio di Ulisse, and some of these concepts that will be referred to in my 10-minute reading of my commentary on the last of the 12 chapters, which is entitled La carne fatta verbo si di fa carne. You see the central theme, as has been pointed out, we've got Sante and Garibaldi are the two central figures in the book. Here we talked about the, Peter just mentioned the Marco Polo connection. So theme number one is that all of the Secondo Occhio di Ulisse is made of abbinamenti bizzarri, strange pairings. The emphasis on what I call screwball pairings come from the introduction by our three excellent translators who produced a very smoothly flowing text. I'm also raising these issues for questions. This is a round table, so these are things that you can come back to what this means. So here are the other screwball pairings, Woody Allen and Lugo Foscolo. Garibaldi Pinocchio has been referred to by Simona. Volponi in Utah, I really wanted to talk about this chapter. It's a beautiful chapter, the second last one. It's very personal, and I really recommend that reading that. But I couldn't fit it in. And then we have the two figures that I'll be talking about. They both have two names too. Okay, now I use the term screwball. So the it's based on the word bizzarro, which becomes bazzano. And again, if anybody wants to talk about this, that's another issue. I just did a little thing on a little video on explaining what a screwball is. Sante has actually written about baseball, so it's appropriate. Silvia made the reference to the I think to the centrifugal and the horizontal and the centrifugal vertical. So this is central. It's introduced in chapter one. It runs throughout the book. Here you see an index thing showing all the places it occurs. They're paired, and it's very interesting. It's sort of a constant reference point in Secondo Occhio di Ulisse. Here we have I think Peter referred to this. We have Garibaldi and Victor Emmanuel and their conflict. And so Garibaldi would be a centrifugal kind of propulsive force, and Vittorio Emanuele II would be more the rooted. so that's something that's also explained in chapter one. Manzoni, who hasn't been mentioned, he's actually very important and very interesting. He's sort of both at once. And there are a couple chapters on Manzoni that are extremely interesting in his Secondo Occhio di Ulisse. I was doing some chronologies. I am working on a review of the book, so I was coming up with some chronologies. If anybody want to talk about the structure of the book as a whole, so I came up with some proposals. It's also interesting to study when things were written. Okay, so now I'm ready for the paper part. Okay, this is the red part. I've got some, can run this little video of Rimanelli, and I'll turn off the sound, see if it actually works. Okay. The final chapter 12, La carne fatta verbo si di fa carne, in Italian, originally appeared in English in 2016 as Word Made Flesh Made Word, published by Bordighera Press following a previous Calandra Institute symposium in honor of Jose Rimanelli. Chapter 12 can be called Sante Matteo's Ulysses chapter. And we know from Primo Levi that a Ulysses chapter is the occasion for posing overarching questions. Levi, in fact, speaks of qualcosa di gigantesco, something gigantic, in a search for a connection with some sort of illuminating intuition of an instant, perhaps the reason for our fate, the question of our being here today. And this is what's going on in Sante Matteo's Ulysses chapter. Chapter 12 was written last, at the time of Professor Matteo's retirement, and it's meant to be a serio ludere reflection on his own career as teacher and writer. As such, the essay tries to tie everything together in a single volume bound by love, everything that across the universe has been dispersed and divided since the Big Bang 13.8 billion years ago. Early on, Matteo tells us about the beginning of Jose Rimanelli's career as a North American writer in Italian and English and in screwball combinations of the two. First of all, we learn the word career in English, or carriera in Italian, derives from the Latin word carraria, which means road or driveway. And then find out from Biglietto di Terza, a Rimanelli text from the 1950s, we found out that text features two types of nowhere buses on roads to nowhere, raising the possibility of professorial or writer careers as inevitable crazy trips to nowhere. Okay, I can go. I want to go full screen, I guess now. All right. Just after introducing the idea of the nowhere bus, Professor Martel goes back to the very beginning of his own career in 1980, where was a Jose Di Manelli essay collection on literary criticism with the revealing title, Il Mestiere del Furbo, The Trickster's Profession, that Matteo turned to at the start of his writing career. This put Jose in the position of Dante Sharon as the boatman of the River Acheron, ferrying Sante towards a life in hell on the academic stage. Specifically, it was Di Manelli's punning attack on the central characters of Pasolini's Ragazzi di Vita as Ragazzi di Carta that inspired Professor Matteo's very first professional article entitled Corpo e Parola in Pasolini, Body and Word in Pasolini. The distinction between, here's a quote from Sante. The distinction between life and paper, in which paper is a synecdoche for literature, suggests an analogous distinction between body and language, between flesh and word, the dichotomy of the title of this essay of mine. The introduction to the flesh and word distinction leads us right to the famous first half of verse 14 of chapter 1 of the Gospel of John in English, and the word became flesh and came to dwell among us. The casual introduction of an intensely solemn verse of the Bible after the initial talk of a writer or professor's career as a ride to nowhere sets up the fundamental dichotomy of chapter 12, in which the sacred is pitted against the secular or even sacrilegious, and the deeply meaningful is contrasted with the utterly meaningless. We are now ready to be taken by the author on a wandering centripety epic voyage of Odysseus. And to get in a Greek frame of mind, we are reminded that the word that is made flesh, in Greek is logos, a term that can refer, that Sante teaches us can refer to all discourse, to reason itself, and even to the achievement of wisdom. So all these things, all these meanings of logos are at stake in the exploration of what it means to be talking about words becoming fleshly incarnated. It's the title of this chapter. Matteo goes back to the story in Biglietto di Terza of Di Manelli and tells us that later on in the story, Di Manelli refers to a different kind of trip on a bus to nowhere. This time is a story about a one-way trip to the harvest fields. This is a migrant or an immigrant of a seasonal agricultural worker who is gunned down by a scorned lover and thus never able to make the return trip. Sante Matteo at this point says that there are two kinds of buses, two kinds of trips, two different non-places where buses go. He explains that in a circular trip that returns to the point of origin after making no stops, the traveler is unable to leave his point of origin behind him. The other kind of trip, the linear one, is a one-way trip to a point of no return in which the traveler never makes it back to that point of origin. So now we arrive at the heart of this chapter, a second comparison contrast of the paired Ulyssean literary voyages of Marco Polo and Dante that have been referred to. This is when the adventure of Italian literature first began in the last quarter of the 13th century. Marco Polo is a circular traveler and Dante is a one-way traveler, and all literary operations are either one sort or the other. So what of Jose Di Manelli's literary travelers over a period of 70 or 80 years of writing? The stage is now set for a concluding account of Di Manelli's own literary celebration of migration that will provide a potential but never fully satisfying a resolution to all undecidable dichotomies so that we can all say yes to life and the flesh, like Molly Bloom at the end of all the crazy literary Irish wandering through Dante's Canto of Paolo and Francesca and Homer's Wine Dark Sea in James Joyce's Ulysses. Okay, so now we've arrived at page 252 of Il Secondo Occhio di Ulisse and the final passage, the last five pages, which begins with a comparison of Jose Di Manelli's trips and adventures to both those in Homer's, to both of Homer's Odysseus and Dante's Ulysses, except Matteo points out Ulysses never sinks to the bottom of the sea as in Dante, but keeps on making wings of his literary oars. right after the mixing up of Homer's Odysseus and Dante's Ulysses, Sante Mateo introduces a passage, this one, on the subject of migration, in which everything is mixed up. English and Italian, geographical locations that have nothing to do with one another, screwball mentioning of sitting at a bar or hanging out at a club med in Senegal. Here's the quote. "Thanks for immigration, signore. Senza l'immigrazione, some of us non si ritroverebbero seduti barside in Limerick, Milano, Port-au-Prince, Ho Chi Minh City, oppure al Club Med in Dakar, Senegal." Mateo explains that having lost his land and himself, the migrant is compelled to substitute and integrate, and in so doing cultivates and nourishes a new culture. Rimanelli is quoted as emphasizing the good that can be found in the new land. Emigration is a wound, no doubt, but then a place of refuge for later rebirth and marriage. Rebirth, rinascita, and marriage, matrimonio, are exceedingly positive, happy ending words that have the effect of healing the initial wound. And this quest for rebirth in a new land turns out to be an endless quest that can only be properly carried out in writing by means of words. And this is how living and writing, words and flesh, can be fused together in a magical sort of hybrid synthesis. Hybridism quote here. The hybridism of the works in English or in many languages, Rimanelli expresses the bond between life and art, between the real and the ideal. One has the impression that for him, living is writing and writing is living. The last theme to be added, and what stands out on the last two pages of the essay collection, pages 256 and 257, it's a strange word, Italian, which is both the title of the second story of a work called Textual by Rimanelli, but also the name of one of the characters in this story, Skip, Clubfoot Italian, Horace, Clubfoot Italian in quotes. This crazy, strange word, Italian, seems to graphically draw out the long I mispronunciation of Italian as Italian to make the adjective completely and crassly American, at the same time as it introduces the idea of the brooding, overly self-examining I of the writer and the professor. And here's this quote. "I is not enough, for sure. If I am all I am of my life, it's not enough." And so we see that the EYE, the I, which is of course title, occhio and everything, pointed to Rimanelli's troubled meditation on his own I, his own ego, at the same time as the word Italian invites us playfully to understand that a satisfying definition of the word Italian is as elusive as fixed identity in Pirandello's Uno, Nessuno, e Centomila. But to conclude, in Rimanelli, there seems to be a tortured penitential quality in this I is not enough declaration, as if Josie Rimanelli, whose name via Hebrew, which Rimanelli once studied, means God saves or God is salvation. as if he, Rimanelli, has some sort of unconfessed inclination to become sort of crazy suffering saint. And what about our author? Does he want to save us all as well? We get a slight hint of this possible aspiration in both elusive figures in a footnote on the second last page, page 256 of Il Secondo Occhio di Ulisse, when we find out that our author, Sante Mateo himself, is a character in the same work Textual in which the Italian appears. Sante Mateo's name is changed to Il Matto Santo, the crazy saint, or Shakespeareanly, the holy fool. And our author seems to really like this version of his name. So that is what lingers at the end of this book of Mateo, this new gospel of Mateo, a reference to some screwball combination of craziness and holiness that can apply to both brothers in the exiled Molisani d'America Italian Professors Club, at both of whom I will concludingly declare Woody Allen-esquely to be a real credit to their mountainous region of origin. Okay, done.
So our next speaker is Daniele Fioretti, who comes to us from Miami University. And the title of his talk is Ulysses and the Silver Screen. Cinema and Ideology in San Matteo's Il Secondo Occhio di Ulisse. Prego.
Grazie. Thank you very much, and sorry if I'm late. My task today is to discuss Ulysses' second eye, to use Sante Matteo's truthful metaphor, and how this Ulysses' second eye is applied to cinema, which, as we all know, is mainly a matter of gaze. I'm going to talk about two essays in the book dedicated to cinema. These essays, at first sight, do not seem to have many things in common. There is Sirene Doppiate, Il richiamo del cinema nell'era fascista, that addresses the topic of film dubbing in Italy during the fascist era, with an almost sociological approach, because it does not analyze a specific movie, but mostly the result of this strategy of dubbing in two famous Italians, two people that will become famous, Italo Calvino and Federico Fellini. Storia come tela di finzioni, Platone, Borges e Bertolucci, on the contrary, is an acute analysis centered on a specific movie, La strategia del ragno, a TV movie directed by Bertolucci in 1970. My point is to show that these two essays have a stronger connection than it looks, since they both illustrate Matteo's approach to ideology, an approach that I will define as Ulyssean. In fact, in both these writings, the binocular gaze of our astute hero, or politropos in Greek, or in Pindemonte's Italian translation, eroe dal multiforme ingegno, goes beyond the boundaries of the interpretation to provide us with a very complex representation indeed. So let's start with Sirene Doppiate. The year is 1936, and Matteo describes a 14-year-old Italo Calvino in Sanremo, which is attracted by the sirens of cinema. Before the years of the political commitment with the Italian Communist Party, Calvino turned to the movies only in search of pleasure and evasion, just, you know, any teenager would do. The sirens were American and European. And Sante Matteo uses this practice of dubbing as a way to present the paradox of Mussolini's cultural autarky. It is true that starting from 1923, the regime tried to eliminate foreign words from the Italian language, so that croissant became cornetto, film became pellicola, sandwich, thanks to D'Annunzio, became tramezzino, etc. In 1940, the Accademia dei Lincei even created a special commission to find and substitute words that could sound too exotic. It is interesting, however, that the regime did not forbid the import of foreign movies. It just tried to Italianize them, starting with the name of silent movie comedians. Therefore, Laurel and Hardy were renamed Crick and Croc, Larry Salmon became Ridolini, André Did was baptized as Cretinetti. Situation became more complicated with the introduction of sound movies. Unlike other countries that were subtitling foreign movies, Italy started dubbing them in Italian in order to domesticate, quote unquote, domesticate their foreignness. It is true that Italy did not produce enough movies annually to satisfy the request of distributors and spectators. Even more importantly, for many fascists, American cinematography, especially Hollywood, represented a model. Luigi Freddi, who was the head of the Direzione Generale della Cinematografia, believed that Italian movies should move away from ideology and become pure entertainment, like many American movies at the time, especially during the years of the Hays Code. Freddi has also visited Hollywood before starting his project on building Cinecittà. It is easy to see that this strategy was, in a sense, short-sighted, nothing more than a surface move. True, Matteo reminds us that together with words and names, the fascists tried to adapt contexts and situations to make them more acceptable to the regime. Like, for example, Quai de Brume, Jean Gabin is a deserter, but in the Italianized version, he's a veteran. Nonetheless, the final effect of dubbing was to introduce foreign cultures in Italy, and even worse, to make this culture sound domestic, just because they were to the Italian audiences, because they were speaking their own language, which in a sense is a much more insidious form, if you want, of cultural colonization, exactly because it was not explicit. So people did not perceive some of these movies as foreign, and that's why they absorbed their contents. Matteo's point is that following the voices of these dubbed sirens of celluloid, young people like Calvino broadened their point of view and became aware of the lies of fascist propaganda. Meanwhile, in Rimini, still in the same essay, another teenager was under the influence of the sirens of cinema, Federico Fellini. According to Matteo, Fellini, like Calvino, thanks to this exposure, will learn to look at the world from an eccentric point of view, to understand, as Matteo writes, the essence of things looking at the margin. In other words, to develop a healthy skepticism against fascism that will later become an opposition to the regime. Not surprisingly, at the end of the war, Fellini was immediately involved in the rebirth of Italian cinema, working as a screenwriter for an episode in the movie Paisan by Roberto Rossellini. Matteo then discusses Fellini's opinion on Amarcord, which he considers a sort of j'accuse against Italy and Italians. In an interview, Fellini linked fascism with immaturity. Italians are immature adolescents and therefore fascists for their entire life, because they will always look for the father figure to delegate their responsibilities. Mussolini, God, the Catholic clergy, someone to follow blindly and, I add, to blame and to use as a scapegoat if things go wrong. Matteo disagrees with Fellini, not so much with his analysis, but with its consequences. According to Matteo, for many Italians, fascism was nothing more than a masquerade, an act like the Commedia dell'arte that did not actually penetrate the collective Italian psyche. So the point made by Matteo is that the fact that Italians are not committed and irresponsible is not a flaw, but almost a quality, because it is the effect of this binocular, going back to Ulisse, view, which is non-unilateral view. The second article, La storia come tela di finzioni, focuses on the movie La strategia del ragno and the short story written by Jorge Luis Borges that loosely inspired it. Matteo starts the analysis discussing an interview to Bertolucci in which the filmmaker draws a comparison between cinema and Plato's allegory of the cave, a myth that was evidently very inspiring for Bertolucci, considering that he also quoted it in the movie Il Conformista, also released in 1970. Matteo is right in underlining the contradiction in Bertolucci's argument that links the liberating potential of cinema with the captivity that characterizes the man changing the cave described by Plato. It would probably make more sense to compare cinema to Plato's cave in a sense that it is not liberating. It does not free, but imprisons the gaze of the spectator. Watching a movie is not like examining a painting. Is in this last case, one's gaze is free to focus on various elements, the main figures, the background, or even small details like clothes or architectural elements. On the contrary, a moviegoer can experience the fictional world of the movie only through the point of view of the movie camera. So it's strictly, his point of view is strictly controlled by the director, though the moviegoer watches only what the director wants them to see. So the gaze of the spectator is forced by the medium to coincide with the gaze of the camera, like the prisoners in a cave were chained to a rock and forced to look at the shadows of a figure that populates the back of the cave. The spectator does not see the world around, but only what the director wants him to see. Only in this sense, I would say self-criticism of the director, the comparison would make sense. However, Bertolucci makes an effort to break the automatism of cinema in a scene of this movie described by Matteo, in which the camera does not follow the movement of the protagonist, Athos Magnani Jr., but it lingers on elements overlooked by the character, emphasizing that the filmmaker, unlike the protagonist, considered these elements of the utmost importance. For example, Matteo notices that when the protagonist is looking at a street sign that bears the name of his father, Athos Magnani Sr., considered by everyone a hero of the resistance movement, the camera tilts up to follow the gaze of the protagonist until he reaches the sign. However, when the camera tilts down, the protagonist is already gone and the camera must find him, meaning that he moved away independently from the movie camera. The same strategy repeats two more times, always when the protagonist finds the name or the statue of his father. This is a flagrant violation of the rule of the invisible narrator developed by American cinematography. So why does Bertolucci does that? It's because he wants us to be aware that the point of view of the camera, mechanical narrator, does not coincide with the protagonist. Maybe because it is also partial, not completely objective and reliable. This strategy is maybe a hint that history is not by the spider web of fiction, as the title of the essay suggests. In fact, in the movie, as Borges' short story, the father was not a hero, but a traitor. I agree with Matteo that the protagonist, Athos Magnani Jr., represents the modern Italy that explores its past and its identity. Therefore, the confrontation is not so much between the father and the son, but between two generations of Italians. The one who lived under fascism, curiously the year is against 1936, and those who came 30 years later. Fascism versus Marxism. And we should not forget that the movie was made after the rupture of the 68, the dramatically juxtaposed two generations. If this is the case, the strategy of detachment previously described is even more important because it signals that the point of view of the director probably expressing a criticism of the beliefs of his own generation. The point that Sante underlines through an interesting analysis of the use of Giuseppe Verdi's Rigoletto in the movie is how much the ideological rhetoric manipulates reality, history, or even art. If Verdi, as Sante reminds us, for the young patriots of the Risorgimento became an acronym to celebrate Vittorio Emanuele Re d'Italia, what is left of the complexity of art? This essay, interestingly, does not mention Ulysses and the binocular perspective, but here I want to misread or overinterpret Sante Matteo, showing that Ulysses has a role here as well. It is not a coincidence, in my opinion, that Sante chose to analyze a movie that puts into question and deconstructs the comforting but simplified image that shows that all the good Italians were anti-fascist and all the bad Italians were fascists. This is obviously an oversimplified generalization. Those who interpret historical conflicts in this way can be considered, borrowing Sante Matteo's Ulyssian metaphor, as ideological one-eyed cyclops, whose vision is unable to encompass the complexity of the reality. It is intriguing that in these two essays, Matteo looks with suspicion both fascism and anti-fascism. His gaze is binocular in ideological terms, firmly focused on the operatic nature of every established ideology. And this is why I want to underline Sante Matteo's internal coherence as an interpreter. His analysis is always binocular. He never seems to be enchanted by the opposite sirens. And this is why his gaze is different from the gaze of the ideological cyclops that take for granted the official truths and fall into one of the two categories. In this sense, Sante as a critic frees his reader from Plato's cave and brings him to the surface to contemplate the sun, of course, using a binocular view. Thank you.
Thank you. So at this point, we can move to some questions and topics maybe that other people want to bring up. Let me ask those of you who are in the audience if you want to ask a question, make an observation, please do so in the Q&A, and I will moderate. I'll give the word first to Silvia, and you being the organizer, and if maybe you want to make a comment or two, or you know, we can just go to some sort of Q&A.
I believe that Sante wanted to say a couple of words.
True. That's right. Sorry, Sante.
Well, I just wanted to thank.
Excuse me. I just figured you're the text here, you know?
That's right.
And you belong to all of us.
I've already spoken, right? So now I've been read. And I've been read brilliantly. So that's what I wanted to say. Mostly I wanted to just say thanks to Anthony and Joseph Shore and the staff of the Calandra for making this possible. To the panelists, to Silvia and the other editors and translators of the book. I'm really humbled and honored by the brilliant readings that I've heard today from all four panelists. I didn't realize that the book was as rich as it appears to be, but it's up to the reader, right? The author plays a minimal role. It's the readers that bring in the brilliance. So if just for the readings that I heard today, it was certainly worth producing this book. So thank you all very much, and I'll be happy to stick around if there are questions or comments that I should address. Thanks.
Thanks, Sante. And for those who don't know, that was a bit of a joke that Sante had a couple of days ago off text, but you also should know that his intellectual formation is indeed, I think I'm not mistaken by saying that you're steeped in semiotics and reader reception theory. And so therefore a text is a text is a text. So let's see. Let me see. There was something. It was a Q&A. Hold on. This is from Carla. Although the first speaker is not here, are there any recommendations of one or two books that most accurately portray the Risorgimento, Garibaldi, and the long-lasting after effects? I don't know who wants to take that. So for the Risorgimento, Garibaldi, and long-lasting after effects. I'm assuming more in English. I'm just assuming that. Am I correct, Carla, that you're talking about works in English? Okay, we didn't yet get an answer, but maybe I caught her off guard. Any suggestions? Sante, what do you think?
I think Peter is still here, has done a lot more research in that area than I have. There's a historian in Carolina whose name now escapes me, who has done a lot of work in the Risorgimento and on Garibaldi in particular. But I can't think of his name. It will come to me because we are in sporadic correspondence. So I can send that link to you, Anthony, and perhaps if you can forward it to those who attended the class today, and she will get it.
By all means, yes, yeah. Let's see, Peter, did you want to chime in? Did you have any text in mind, Peter?
Well, not any one particular text. I think, as I said, I mean, maybe this is the time to actually, you know, acknowledge that we are not just now professional speaking, kind of impartial, objective prose, but we ourselves are agents, actors, and representatives of this history. I remember distinctly some 20, 25 years ago, when Sante Matteo started talking about Garibaldi reading his autobiographia and everything, you know, at these meetings, I think the AIS, I remember. And there was a kind of like, he had to do it like kind of like almost excusing himself for bringing up Garibaldi, you know? Now, it was different than in Italy. In Italy, it was because he was being attacked by the left, all kinds. You know, Garibaldi is like a populista, Garibaldi non ha la coscienza di classe, blah, blah. And he was being dismissed. In the United States, the Italianists basically say, you know, we don't talk about these things. If we talk about anybody, it's either Mazzini or maybe the politics of Cavour. Nobody bothered to talk about Vittorio Emanuele II, and nobody, and Garibaldi was a folk hero. What can you say about a folk hero? But as he says in the book, I mean, there is a beautiful reconstruction of how the Duce's name comes from like four of the greatest revolutionaries, nation building liberators. I think it has to do with our society today and also our profession that we tend to downplay these incredible actors of history. I mean, you're right, the man wrote in four or five languages, he traveled everywhere, he was well received, it was more written, it was more praised than Napoleon at some point, who was like the number one hero in history, at least in modern history, that is. I think now that we have the instruments and the sensibility of the post-colonial, of the transnational, of the relevance of the diaspora studies and of mobility studies, I think this is a good time to go back and reinterpret and review and rethink this character who, let's face it, I mean, you know, as Viscusi said, you know, he lived long enough to see Italy, you know, being taken from the poor and given to the rich. You know, if national ideologies have a consciousness in the sense like a sense of self-critique, well, then Garibaldi should be one author who's long overdue, just like Marco Polo, by the way. And this, again, I cannot stress how important that essay was on Dante and Marco Polo. Now, maybe we should rewrite the rewriting of some sort of a more open and flexible canon should start from all these actors who lived most of their life, half of their lives outside of Italy and defined Italy and inspired Italy and inspired all the social classes, especially the silenced ones, the ones without a language, who were like those 6, 7, 8 millions who either emigrated or got dispersed. So, I mean, I can't think of, I don't know which historian he's thinking of, but I've gone through so many in the past few years. If we're gonna have a discussion on this via email, I will certainly catch up and tell you what I think. But yeah, I appreciated the fact that Sande made me rethink and appreciate the role, the importance of Giuseppe Garibaldi, who was the only true Repubblicano, not Repubblichino, you know, in the whole mix. Now, let me just stop right here and give other people some time. By the way, I have to, as I announced in about 5 minutes, I have to go because I have a class, which is I'm already late to. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
I'll just add, in addition to Garibaldi being critiqued by the left in the 60s and 70s, when Italy was about to celebrate its 150th anniversary, there were also a lot of attacks on the whole notion of Risorgimento,
yes,
and on Garibaldi from the south. Statues and plaques to Garibaldi being torn down the same way that now we are tearing down Robert E. Lee and other statues here, because from the south, seeing him not so much as a liberator, but a colonizer, an invader.
That's
not true, but there were manifestations of that kind of protest leading up to the 150th birthday of Italy. So a lot of writing going on, rethinking a lot of those issues.
Yeah, I agree with you because that was kind of an Italian version of cancel culture, and you're right. I remember the paper you delivered to Stony Brook, and I said, what a fantastic paper. No, that was the one with Pinocchio, I'm sorry. The one, but the one about Garibaldi was before. It's this actually points to some what I've found in another context, some of the limitations of the contemporary excesses of some post-colonial criticism. In other words, if you ever held a sword in your hand, you are a conquistador. If you ever stepped in another country, you are an occupier, and it becomes kind of, and that kind of discourse picked up in the media so much so that the young people would actually think like that, that, you know, Garibaldi was not someone to be looked up to, but it was like a colonized. That's a little bit goes with the I hate to talk like this, but almost like the superficiality of some contemporary criticism. And we have to do something to redress that, you know, in different ways. Bless it.
So Peter, let me ask you, referring to the two things that came to mind, one when Santi was talking about, and that is the some people who do not want to recognize the permeability of borders, number one. Or don't even want to recognize the borders. And then the other thing is, I was wondering, when you say superficiality, are you talking about, you know, the so-called intellectuals who are working on it, or is it more of a general discourse? Are you thinking in terms of that?
No, it's a general discourse, but it informs a lot. Look, you know, from all the work on the postmodern, what I picked up was the good aspects of post-colonial critique, gender critique, and all of that. But it's gotten to the point where, by the way, talk about Marco Polo, I did a lot of work on Christopher Columbus, and I published on it. I mean, it just cannot be, even as someone as Walter Mignolo, you know, who is one of the leading brains on the conquistadores, I mean, they still go on thinking that before the Europeans came on this side of the Atlantic, everything on this side was like paradise. I mean, have they really studied what the Aztec used to do to their neighbors? I mean, you know, altro che Visigoti, Ostrogoti. So it's a kind of a fiction of the past. And I think this book invites us to review the past. It turns out that some of the greatest Italian writers and influencers, in a way, were people who actually had to live outside of Italy. You know, it was like Italy seen from the outside. As I said, like, you know, Nietzsche understood Germany when he was living in Rapallo. He says, oh my God, I can finally see exactly what you guys are all about, you know, because once you're inside, you only see the trees, you don't see the forest. So there's a lot of work ahead in that context. But it does imply having to deal with the way criticism has evolved in the last 30 years. Before that, it was partitico, di destra, di sinistra. Okay, now it's whether, you know, you're trying to liberate a country, but then at one point you say, you use an expression that's not palatable, and boom, everything points to that expression as, this guy was a colonialist, this guy was an imposter, this and that. I mean, it's they need a little bit more hermeneutica here. They need some more discourse analysis, you know what I mean? And you're right about, Sander said, you know, we have this text, it could become an end in itself. The story that he wrote about Foscolo is something that I've always complained about. You know, you all remember you went to high school when we used to read Dante, there was a due versi sopra and 50,000 words of criticism in six languages underneath, to the point that by the time you get out of high school, you hate Dante, you hate Manzoni, you hate everybody. Why? You know, criticism should also be a way of mediating and explaining, not just condemning, or overkill, which makes it becomes una pratica degli eletti, you know, or dei privilegiati. Enough of that nonsense. Let's bring literature to the people.
Any other comments? I'm thinking we have to have another session about criticism. That's what I'm thinking. Yeah.
I want to say hello and goodbye to everybody, but I have to leave, okay?
Okay, buona lezione.
Ciao. Ci sentiamo per email a tutti quanti. Un piacere. Ciao, ciao. Ciao. Take care, Daniel.
Okay, any other comments? We're getting towards the end. Silvia, did you want to, you opened it up so eloquently, would you like to sort of bring it to some sort of an parentheses conclusion?
Not sure if it is possible to conclude this because too many open points remain, which is what strikes me all the time about this book. Every time we open it and read something, another idea comes out. And one thing though that I wanted to point out is that the book wanted to bridge again the scholarship of Sante to Italy, to the other side of the borders. And they've been able to present the book to a few places in Italy, but definitely I feel like it needs to be it needs to be known more over there. And we need to open the dialogue with the other side of the border a little bit more. So I'd like to leave it like that. Let's see if we can find out some ways of opening it up to the other side. Yes.
I agree totally. I think that the importance of not just a session like this, but of a publication of this sort, you know, someone like Sante Matteo, who's mm-hmm. been quite prolific throughout his career. You publish here, you publish there. Sometimes your best work is in one book in 2010 and the second one is 1995 and so on and so forth. And they get lost. And when you put them together, you see a type of discourse, a linear mode of thought that you see was there all the time, you know, and so I'm glad for this. And it goes back to Sante and I go back a long time to some of our early conferences in the 80s, and we won't recount it, but I'm just thinking of one in Florida, if you remember, Sante, when you and I and Antonio Vitti were in some cases praised, in some cases excoriated by an elder statesman at that time. So, but I'm delighted we were able to do this. I'm delighted to you, Silvia, for thankful for taking up the task of, you know, doing it all. So with that, let me thank everyone. Daniele, Sante, Wiley, Peter, Silvia. And then let me also thank behind the scenes, both Carmen Pizzirusso and Eugenio Pizzorno. And with that, I say arrivederci a domani, because tomorrow we conclude with the keynote speaker, Donna Gavaccia, who is Emerita Professor of History from the University of Toronto, and who will speak to us on Where is Italy? Borders and Borderlands, from Metaphor to Geopolitics. And that, I think, we will conclude with a very rich keynote speech. So with that, arrivederci a domani.